So we're going to look at some of the common problems that you get on the 1.8T engine from the Volkswagen Audi group. Now, it's actually a very reliable engine, so I certainly don't want to give the impression that this is particularly unreliable. But knowing what the problems are in advance can save you an awful lot of expense, because most of these problems will just get worse and worse over time if ignored. And just picking up on those symptoms early on can save you a substantial repair bill if you catch them quickly enough. So we're going to talk about the problem areas, things to look out for, the typical symptoms that you get when these problems start to manifest. And we're also at the end going to look at some of the problems you get when you've tuned your 1.8T. So the 1.8T has got a long history with Volkswagen Audi Group. They tend to reuse their designs on blocks over and over again and just revise them. So way back in 1972, we had the first edition of this engine block come out. It was the EA287, but we're going to focus on the more recent EA113 variant, the 1.8 turbo, which was fitted in so many different cars, and it really is a sparkling engine and it has lots of untapped power and potential. They're typically reliable. If you look after them and keep up with the servicing, you will usually see about 250,000 miles before you hit any kinds of problems. So first off, we're going to talk about rough running. So there's a few issues that crop up that cause the 1.8T to idle roughly or just have flat spots or lack power in certain places. I've got a small favor to ask. Please drop us a like, because that really helps us to get out there. Please also use the comments section. Tell us what car you've got, what engine you've got, because that'll help me to tailor future videos so they'll be of interest to you personally. And if you haven't subscribed, please do so, because again, that helps us to get out here. And tell your mates about us. I'm going to flag up six common problems that cause rough running and rough idling. So the most common issue that causes this is the mass airflow sensor, the MAF. As it ages, it degrades, and as the readings start going back to the ECU incorrectly, the boost supplied, the fueling and the timing will all be wrong, because the ECU has got the wrong information to work from in the first place. So replacing the MAF, or initially just getting it cleaned and just making sure it's up to spec, can make a big difference to those rough idle problems, and that should really be the first place that we look. Coils and plugs are the next most common issue. They will typically cause a misfire. It could be a regular misfire, it could be a complete one cylinder failure, it could be an intermittent fault where you get lumpy misfires, or if the engine's warmed up you're fine and cold starts you've got all sorts of problems and difficulties. So just identifying the coil pack or the plug that's causing the problem and swapping this out, it's a really easy DIY job, will just completely remove that problem. And I'd recommend that you get them all done at the same time rather than just focus on the one problem one, because it often indicates that the rest are on their way out. But we're going to have a look at coil packs in a little more detail later on in this video, because it was quite a big issue. There was some faulty coil packs fitted throughout the Volkswagen Audi group, and just knowing how to diagnose the problems and work out that that is the issue can actually save you a lot of garage bills and maintenance costs. If the plugs get soiled, which is quite common, as they age they will get more sooty, coked up, the electrodes will start to degrade over time and the spark will become weaker and maybe even fail intermittently. So just changing those spark plugs will make a big difference, and getting good quality plugs with iridium tips can work very, very well in the 1.8T engine, or at least in most applications of it. So the next most common area is a vacuum leak, where you've got a split pipe or a faulty connector between two pipes within the engine bay, and these can cause the engine to lose boost. It can create really weird readings that the ECU doesn't know what to do with, and that can cause all sorts of flat spots and running issues. So check all of the connections, make sure there's no leaks. You can get a leak detector or just listen out in the engine bay very, very carefully for the telltale sign of leaking air, and it may only leak at certain RPM ranges as the pressure builds up within the engine. So be aware of that. Just testing an idling engine, you may well never find the vacuum leak, but if the engine is revved and you've got something to work from, that might actually manifest itself. And it certainly wouldn't hurt to replace old worn rubber hoses and just check all of the connections are good within the engine bay. So the O2 sensor is another common issue that crops up that can cause running problems and flat spots. So it could be suffering from just general wear and tear. It could have carbon build up on it, which is degrading its ability to to sniff out the O2 in the exhaust. Again, replacing that faulty sensor should deal with the rough idling if that was the cause of it in the first place. The coolant temperature sensor, again, that's something we're going to look at in a little more detail in a little bit, but the coolant sensor is telling the ECU how hot the engine is running, and if that's not operating correctly, it can cause the engine to overheat, and it can certainly affect the performance and smooth running of the car. So let's break down some of the most common problems and faults that crop up the 1.8T engine, just to help you to diagnose them and give you a starting point to know where to look for these problems in the first place. So the coolant sensor we've just mentioned, but taking that apart and looking in a little bit more detail, the coolant sensor is telling the ECU how hot the engine is running. As it gets old, it starts to deteriorate, don't we all? So if the ECU is getting incorrect readings, it messes up its calculations, and that can cause it to overfuel or underfuel, to run rich or lean, depending on whether it's being told the engine is hotter than it is or cooler than it is. So neither is an ideal condition and can really affect the running of the car. And if that's left to go on for a period of time, that problem can get worse and worse, and you can have excessive carbon buildup within the engine because it was running rich, or it can soil other sensors and spark plugs within the engine. So you really want to jump on that one quite quickly and fix it. So common symptoms of this, you might get an engine warning light come up. The engine temperature sensor on the dashboard may well stop displaying a reading, or you might just get poor performance. You might have a lumpy tick over or flat spots in the engine, or certain points of the RPM range where the engine just doesn't seem to respond, or it can cause the engine to overheat. So another issue to be aware of is oil sludge buildup. Now, oil is quite complex. It's got lots of layers, very fine layers and very thick layers, and they all work together to keep the engine cool, to keep it lubricated, and to make sure the oil is there in the very extreme operating conditions within the engine as everything is spinning round and getting hotter and colder. So the engine oil does a lot of work, but if you've got sludge building up in the oil, that really affects its ability to lubricate the engine and accelerates the engine wear if you're not careful. If the oil that you use is too thin, it'll likely seep into the cylinders, or at least the thin parts of the oil will, and it'll just burn off, leaving you with the thicker residue that doesn't flow as well and doesn't lubricate as well. If the engine oil is too thick to start with, it just won't flow around and lubricate the engine as it should, and it's going to be exposed to hotter areas for longer periods of time, again burning off those finer elements of that oil that help to protect the engine. So the typical causes of the sludge buildup are using the wrong grade of oil, or just leaving those oil changes too long. You must keep on top of the oil changes on your 1.8T. You must also use the correct grade of oil that the Volkswagen Audi group specify. If the oil level drops too low, that can affect its ability to coat the inside of the engine and may well leave bits of oil exposed to hot areas, again boiling off those finer elements of the oil that are so essential, just basically leaving you with a sludge. So the engine oil you're using, your 1.8T, it must absolutely conform to those Volkswagen specifications. They've thought long and hard and agreed on a very specific grade of oil that works well in this engine, and you must keep up with the oil change intervals and schedules very, very reliably. If you start to skimp on that and go too long, you're starting to get that sludge building up from the oil as it's degrading. So a long life Volkswagen Audi group service is typically performed at 24,000 miles, which to my mind, and a lot of people I speak with, it just seems too long. If you've got a synthetic oil, they theoretically can last that long, but if you're using the car and driving it hard, or the engine is doing a lot more work than it might normally do, or you're just an enthusiastic driver, it certainly makes sense to shorten those intervals. A lot of people on our forums and that I've spoken to with the 1.8T engine, including myself, will recommend you change the oil every 9,000 miles. It's expensive, but it really does protect the engine and keep it in good working order. But certainly change the oil at least once every year or every 9 months, depending on the mileage that you're doing. Even if you don't hit the 9,000 miles within that time period, still get that oil renewed. So the 1.8T engine typically requires about 3.75 litres of oil. Some take up to 4.35 litres, so it does vary on the application. There were transversely mounted engines and longitudinally mounted engines, and the sump design and the design of the engines is slightly different, so that may well alter the characteristics. So check in your handbook and make sure the correct level of oil is in the sump. So in my handbook, it recommended 5W30 fully synthetic oil. It must conform to the Volkswagen 50400 or 50700 standard, which is a very, very specific standard for oils. Not all of them will meet that standard, even if it meets the 530 specification. So when I bought oil for my 1.8T, it was the Castrol Long Life SLX III or 3. So another issue to look out for is water pump issues. So as the water pump gets old, the plastic impellers on the actual pump itself can break off, or just generally the pump can degrade and just not work as effectively. So that results in less coolant flowing around the engine. It can lead to the engine overheating. In some cases where the pump is completely shot, there'll be no circulation of water around the engine. And that's pretty dangerous because the engine is just going to get hotter and hotter and hotter until it fails catastrophically. So when you replace the cam belt, it's a good idea to also change the water pump at the same time. The labour's almost identical. You've got the engine apart, you've got the belts off, so you may as well just change the water pump along with the cam belt. And you're not doing it that regularly, but by doing that, you'll avoid having that breakdown problem midway through a cam belt change, and you'll save yourself a little bit of money and the inconvenience of having a breakdown. So common symptoms that you get from water pump issues is a noisy water pump. It might start making a noise that you've not heard before. It could be rattly, it could be bubbly. There's a whole range of different noises it can make depending on what is failing within the water pump. You might get overheating in the engine. You might start to have steam shooting out from the radiator release valve. If that's the case, stop driving. You've got a problem there that you need to address quite quickly, and that will get worse and worse and lead to very expensive repair bills if you ignore it. Coolant leaks sometimes happens with water pump failures, but that's generally down to a bad join or a bad pipe connection or a split pipe somewhere within the engine bay. So if you notice coolant leaking out, just check all of the joins and try and identify where that leak is actually coming from before you just identify the water pump as being the problem. And if you notice the engine overheating, the most common cause of that is a problem with the water pump. So straight away, just take it into a garage or do it yourself and just get that water pump replaced and changed. So coil pack failure, we spoke about at the beginning as being a common problem. So in these engines, it was a fairly new thing really, looking at lots of other engines contemporary of the years that this came out, where each spark plug had its own coil pack rather than just having a coil and a distributor to take the amplified charge to each of the plugs. Each plug now has its own coil pack. Now those coil packs, they have copper in them. The engine gets very hot, it goes through cold cycles, you've got the expansion and contraction of the metal, there's a lot of voltage running through it and lots of vibration within the engine. So it's hardly surprising that over time these coil packs will fail. Now you'll usually get a failure on just one coil pack. So if you plug in a diagnostic reader, it will typically tell you which cylinder is experiencing a misfire. If you swap the coil pack from the faulty cylinder to a good cylinder, you'll notice that the fault moves. And if that fault has moved to another cylinder, you know that that's the coil pack that's been identified as being faulty. So replacing that coil pack will solve the problem that you're facing. And it's a very easy job to do, certainly a DIY job. I wouldn't ever just replace one coil pack. I would do them all at the same time, because often when one goes, it's just a matter of time before the others start to go. So they're all usually experiencing the same conditions within the engine and were manufactured with the same materials at the same time. So it's quite likely that you're going to have other failures cropping up on those other packs. So typical symptoms that you get from coil pack problems, you'll get performance issues, flat spots, misfiring, poor starting. You might even have the engine warning light coming on. So another issue to look out for is timing belt and chain tensioner problems. Think about the amount of work the timing belt and the tensioner is doing. You're in the engine bay, it's vibrating, everything is spinning all the time, it's warming up, it's cooling down, so it's quite likely that that's going to fail. So I would certainly recommend that on most 1.8T engines, you replace the timing belt and tensioner every 60,000 miles. In a lot of Audi handbooks, it recommends a much longer duration of time between these changes, but in my mind, that's just asking for trouble. If the cam belt goes, or you have a problem with that, you've got substantial issues within the engine. You'll probably end up damaging the valves and maybe even the cylinders as everything just gets out of sync and starts crashing into one another. So keep on top of that simple maintenance item and don't cut corners. It really is a false corner cut. So common tuning problems on the 1.8T. So we're taking a 1.8T engine and we've upped the power. We may have remapped it. We may have changed change the turbo and some other components within the engine. So there's a few things just to look out for that typically cause problems. We've got another video coming up that goes in depth into the 1.8T engine and tuning it. So keep an eye out for that. It's in our production at the moment, so it'll be released very, very soon. So the N75 valve can often fail, particularly when you've tuned the car and the engine is producing more power. The turbo is working much harder than it used to. So the N75 valve just controls the wastegate. What does the N75 valve do? So the N75 valve isn't actually a blow-off valve or a dump valve. It just regulates the opening and closing of the wastegate on the turbo. So with an electronic pulse going to the N75 valve, a pulse of air is diverted to this copper dome on the turbo wastegate, pushing down the diaphragm, opening the flow to the turbo's exhaust intake. So when boost becomes lumpy or irregular, or you're having boost problems, it is probably down to a faulty N75 valve. Swapping out the N75 valve is a relatively simple job to do, and there are performance alternatives around that last longer and they perform better. You get smoother and faster operation than you do with the factory stock N75 valve. So in a tuned engine, it would certainly be worth thinking about upgrading the N75 valve, considering the work that it does and the vital role that it plays within the engine. So another common issue is where people fit a filter, an air filter, to the engine that is impregnated with oil, and what tends to happen is they over oil it. So if there's a lot of oil in that filter, that oil will eventually migrate as the air flows through the filter, and it will get onto the airflow sensor, and that will cause the airflow sensor to fail or to give false readings. So you'll notice hesitation, difficulties and flat spot within the engine, maybe even at certain RPM points. So if this has happened and you remove the MAF sensor and you find that it has got a film of oil over and it's slightly dirty, use an isopropyl alcohol solution to just clean it off very, very gently and make sure it is completely clean and completely dry. Put it back together and hopefully you've addressed the problem, but then look at what caused the oil to build up, and it is almost certainly going to be the oil that was used in that performance filter. So just make sure that there's not too much oil. It's a good idea to have a light misting of oil on some of these filters just to trap the extra dirt particles, but don't overdo it. You're not going to help yourself by over oiling those filters. So atmospheric blow-off valves, a lot of people use them on tuned project cars, but it's not suitable for the 1.8T engine. So it's a very closed system, so that sudden loss of air from the system can cause the ECU to panic and throw up all sorts of fault codes and go into limp home mode because it thinks something is wrong. And certainly something is wrong in the engine, because it had all that air pressure and suddenly that air pressure has gone. So what your dump valve will typically do within the engine is when you lift off the throttle, it'll dump that air back into the intake, where it can help to keep the turbo spinning and you've got pressurized air ready to go back in. So you certainly don't get a flat spot when you go back on the throttle. Otherwise, if you didn't have one at all, when you lift off the throttle, you've just got a terrific buildup of air as the turbo is still producing lots of compressed air and it has to go somewhere. So a lot of people use a blow-off valve to the atmosphere to create that nice swoosh sound, but we're not here to have nice sounding engines, or at least a lot of us are not here to have nice sounding engines. We're worried about the performance, and just dumping that nicely compressed air to the atmosphere is not a great idea in my book. So we've got videos coming up covering a lot of different aspects of the 1.8T engine. So if you haven't subscribed, please do so. We're going to be looking at the K03, the K03S and the K04 turbo, how they can be tuned, how you can swap them around and performance alternatives to those. And we're also looking at tuning the 1.8T engine. A lot of people have said the engine block is capable of handling 350 horsepower. So we're going to look at how to achieve that. And we're also going to look at the typical problems and pitfalls that you get when you start tuning the 1.8T engine. So please stay tuned. If you haven't subscribed already, please do so. And please throw us up a like, because that really helps us to get out there. Thanks for watching.